There's a lot of great things happening at Tennessee Athletics.
I believe this city is going to be upside down tonight.
Season-long party continues at Rocky Top.
Hello, everyone, and a late Happy New Year, but not a new podcast. Welcome back to the Everything Orange Tennessee Athletics podcast. I hope you all enjoyed a wonderful time with friends and family over the holidays. I know I ate a lot of food, watched a ton of sports, and also did some light reading. So what more could you ask for? But anyways, onto the podcast today. We've got a great guest kicking off 2024 with us that I am so excited for you all to hear more from. He's a graduate transfer guard who has made an immediate impact on Rocky Top from just about every spot on the floor. In his first week as a volunteer, he earned SEC Player of the Week honors and hit his 1,000 career point milestone. He averages double digits per game and earned a career-high 37 points against UNC earlier this season. Oh yeah, and don't forget his dunk heard around the world when the Volunteers played their first exhibition game of the season against Michigan State. With that all being said, please welcome to the Everything Orange podcast, Dalton Knecht. Dalton Knecht, thank you so much for joining me on our first episode back in 2024.
Of course, thanks for having me.
So we have so much to discuss with you because I know that fifth year transfer on the team, some people might know your game and know you, but I want everyone to get to know you outside of just basketball. So to start us off, let's do some get to know you questions.
Okay, perfect.
Best Christmas gift that you received this year?
Ooh, I would say being able to go back home to Colorado to see my parents.
That sometimes isn't always possible with y'all's schedule, so getting to go home and enjoy some time with family, I bet, was great. If money was not an object, what would you do for a day?
I don't know. I'd probably have to go see what my friends are doing and go do something with them. So.
Okay, traveling? Is that
probably.
On? Okay.
Somewhere probably go to like, I don't know, like Miami or somewhere I haven't been. Or
okay,
somewhere.
Fun.
Maybe I'll go back to Nashville.
Yeah.
Was fun.
Yeah? So. Are you into country music, country,
nope.
Western?
Okay. I never listened to country till...
till you came here?
Yeah, and then a couple teammates played it and stuff, so okay. Then I had to listen to it. So.
What are your thoughts?
It's not that bad.
I mean, is it like your new pregame hype music?
I mean, I don't listen to it like that, yeah. But if like they put it on, I'll listen to it.
Okay.
But otherwise, I don't listen.
Okay,
to it.
Is there a song that... like you really like to hear if you're gonna hear country music, it's like play.
No, not really.
Okay, we're working you there.
Yeah, I'm working. Yeah, Rocky Top.
There
Rocky Top's great. They caught me on camera singing it.
Good. If you could have dinner with anybody, dead or alive, who would it be?
Probably I'll just have to say my favorite basketball player, KD.
Okay.
So other than that, maybe like Lil Baby or something.
Okay, very nice. So, rap music is more your style.
Yeah.
Got it. Have you ever had a nickname? And if so, what was it?
It's mostly been just DK
okay.
Or just D. So
did that start from a young age?
Yeah, just those two have always stayed around for me. So,
if you could live anywhere in the world, in the country, where would it be?
Minnesota. I'd want a lake cabin
out
there.
Oh, okay.
I want a lake cabin out in Minnesota.
That is so unique. I wasn't expecting that.
I know.
Have you been to Minnesota before?
Yeah, I got tons of family out there. So
okay. How many pairs of shoes do you own in your closet?
Too many, probably. I have an addiction.
Oh, yeah?
Say. My dad started it. He has a lot of shoes, and they got me to get a lot of shoes, and then probably got around, like, 120. To.
You're kidding.
Yeah, it's bad.
Do they have their own closet?
Yes, of course.
Of course.
And it's, I mean, I wear them also.
Fair.
But I know, like, tons of basketball players have tons of shoes.
Yeah, no, so I mean, it makes sense.
Yeah.
I wouldn't expect anything less of you. Your favorite pair, though, that you own?
There's too many. I got a couple Travis Scotts and stuff like that, so
okay.
I don't know. It'd probably be one of those.
Okay, are you Nike? Are you...
Oh, yeah, Team
more?
Nike.
Okay, Nike. New Balance is kind of a thing.
New Balance. I've been getting into New Balance. New
yes.
Balance and Nike, they're comfy.
Yes,
very
they're
comfy.
Very comfortable. I just got a pair of 550s for Christmas, so I was, like, excited about that. But I have, like, 10. So I'm working on my collection.
You're getting up there.
There you go. Can maybe one day I can compete with you. Your biggest fear?
Snakes. Snakes are, I don't like snakes.
No.
They slither. They shouldn't be
like
a thing. Yeah. They should be wiped off the planet.
No, I agree with you.
Yeah.
I don't do snakes either. When you have Ox, what artist are you playing?
Lil Baby, Future. I'll play some Young Dolph.
Okay.
Just kind of depends on my mood.
Okay.
So.
Are you usually on Ox for the team?
I try to be on Ox as much as I can.
Okay.
Or
do they like you being on Ox?
I think so.
Okay.
So,
good.
I mean, before games, me and Z will always try to get it, or JG will try to tell the managers what to play.
Oh, nice. So. Good, good. Last movie that you saw in the theater?
Ooh. probably like an Avengers movie or something. Okay. I haven't been to the movie theater in forever.
I know. COVID took me out of the theaters for a while. I can't even remember what my first one back was to the theater.
I don't think I've been back.
Really?
I love going to movies.
You need to go over to the Westtown Mall because they have the recliner chairs.
Ooh, those
and
are
they
the best.
Yes, they serve you. You can order off the menu. They'll bring you like a whole meal. It's a whole thing.
That's bougie.
Yeah,
that's nice.
That was my first experience. And
I need to go over there.
Yeah, you do. Your go-to karaoke song?
I don't know.
Do you do karaoke?
No. Never never even tried it.
So you're on aux, but you're not on the mic. You don't.
Yeah, I don't rap or sing or anything like that.
That's fair. If you could only eat one meal for the rest of your life, what would it be?
Steak. Steak and like lobster.
Okay.
I like those. Yeah. Those are two good
surf
combos.
Surf and turf.
Yeah. Perfect.
Fries on the side.
Oh yeah. Kay. Got to with some ranch.
That is my favorite condiment.
Ranch is the best.
Who would you have play you in a life movie?
In a life movie. Ooh. I'm bad with the actors' names, so
then I maybe should.
I don't know.
Asked.
Yeah, but I'd say like I don't know. I just want somebody funny like Will Ferrell or someone like that.
Yeah,
just to,
I see.
Just
it.
To make me laugh or something. I don't know. Someone like that.
Yeah, someone lighthearted. Yeah. Doesn't take themselves too seriously.
Crack a couple jokes.
Yeah, exactly. Perfect. Good. Okay. Very fun. Now we'll get to the more personal part about your story. So let's go all the way back to your early childhood and growing up in the suburbs of Denver, Colorado. Kind of talk me through what was that like growing up with just your parents because you were an only child.
Yeah, I mean, it was nice. I mean, I liked always just kind of being alone and just chilling by myself, doing whatever I want when my parents let me stay home and stuff. And I'll just chill with my dog, go shoot some hoops out in the yard with him. He'd sometimes come out and chase the ball, try to steal it from me.
Yeah.
So, I had a lot of fun just chilling by myself, play video games inside or just wait for them to get home.
Now, were your parents, being an only child, were they kind of the helicopter parents? Were they really involved in your life? Because I know, personally speaking, mine were super involved in my life growing up.
Yeah, I mean, they've always been super supportive and always in my life, like always like helping me out. Like I'll call them after every game and we'll talk about the whole entire game and stuff. And I mean, they're always there for me if I ever need them. So I got great parents.
And they both grew up playing basketball too. And your mom in high school and your dad went to college and played some. So for you, when did basketball start for you? Was it as early as you could walk that you were dribbling a ball
I didn't want to play basketball at all for forever.
Really?
I was a football. Like I loved football, like collected cards, like everything, helmets. I try to be a football junkie. And
then
I was just getting beat up because I was too little and getting bruises all over. My parents were kind of just like, you're too little for this stuff. Like, try basketball. Like, we loved it. The same thing with my dad. He got beat up. And then I just fell in love with it ever since. My dad would just take me every weekend and every single night into the gym. We'd just go out and work out every single night. And I loved it.
So when was that? What age was that for you that things kind of changed?
It was about going into the sixth grade, fifth grade-ish, kind of just making the jump, fifth grade.
Yeah.
And I just fell in love, didn't even want to play football no more, just straight basketball.
Did it feel very natural? Did it come very natural to you in the beginning?
Yeah. I mean, my dad said I picked up pretty fast on a lot of stuff, when he transitioned to basketball, he just kind of fell in love with it, and I loved it. Always listened to him, watched videos when I stayed home.
Okay.
So, yeah, and then I just started watching, practicing moves and stuff, and just pretty much got lost in the game.
Your dad too, can you talk about like how he helped kind of nurture that competitive nature in you, because you guys would go out and play together regularly until something kind of
happened. But we'd always play like horse and he wouldn't take it easy. He'd always try to beat me and stuff, and then eventually when I got to beat him, I'm competitive, I want to win.
Yeah.
And he always like constantly would always talk crap to me and stuff, so I mean, I'd always talk back to him, and yeah, so then it came around seventh grade. I was starting to beat him, starting to pass, and then he clotheslined me. And
no!
And then that was the last one-on-one game we ever played, because he never will want to play me again.
Yeah, honestly, I wouldn't want to either.
I wish he'd play me right now.
Yeah, no, if he does, let me know. I'd love to be the...
Now I'm full grown.
Yes, exactly. Call me up. Andy, he can do the call on it. I can silent report on it. It'll be great. It'll be a great
Perfect.
Time.
We'll pack out TBA.
Yes, let's do it. Now, I have to ask, too, because growing up out in the West, was snowboarding, skiing, those winter activities, did you pick up any of those? Did you not even want to?
I mean, my parents used to ski and stuff, but I mean, I really didn't have time to ski because of basketball, always winter sport. And I don't know. I want to, but at the same time, it's just I don't got the time. So, yeah. I mean, I used to go sledding, if that counts.
Yeah, there you go. Same,
sledding, I guess. And throwing some snowballs around, but other than that, I never got a
really
chance.
Picked it up. So let's talk to now, going into high school, you were 5'5", and you ended your senior year 6'3". Can you just talk about how you grew personally, how your body grew, and then through the game of basketball, how you saw that develop as well?
Yeah, I mean, my freshman year, I was like 5'4", and I was a point guard, and I was a point guard my whole life, so. Okay. When I started growing, I was about 5'6" my sophomore year to 5'7", and then junior year, that's when I just shot up to 6 foot.
Oh my gosh.
Just like, that's kind of like my dad, how he went through high school. So, I mean, then I started playing the wing a little bit, but also, I mean, I was also to keep my like point guard skills kind of so I could play multiple positions. So it ultimately worked out, and then 6'3". As a senior, and then I grew 3 more inches in junior college. So
your mom must have been taking you to the mall like every month to get new clothes, new shoes. I'm sure you were growing through all of them so quickly.
Yeah, they were smart. They got a couple size. They got a size bigger for
me. Okay, good. So I could grow into them.
Yeah,
good.
They were smart.
Yes, they knew what they were doing.
Yes.
And then in terms of like academics, I know that was something that didn't necessarily stop you from wanting to pursue your dreams after high school. So can you talk about what that was like, and then how you decided, like, okay, there have been other paths of these pro athletes that I've admired. Doesn't have to all be linear like most people.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people say, like, they don't want to go JUCO and stuff, but, like, JUCO's been, like, my favorite thing throughout my college experience. Like, I love JUCO. Like, I talk to all my bros every single day still. Like, it's like we're, like, pretty much brothers out there. Like, you're just in one little dorm, and you're all sticking together every single night, getting good food or – you're always chilling with each other every single night. So, like, you had a close, really close bond with them, especially, like, a lot of us grew against each other, playing against each other, hating each other.
Yeah.
Then we got to be best friends and play video games, go out and hoop against other people, and just it was an awesome experience. So.
And correct me if I'm wrong in saying this, but I feel like it makes you appreciate what you have now even more, because at that JUCO level, money is hard to come by for the program. You know, you're lucky to get these things that now being at a school in the SEC are like probably unexpected for you and what you've experienced.
Yeah, I mean, you take it all in. I mean, seeing all the crazy resources you got here and you just seen it at a JUCO, even at my previous school, it's crazy. I mean, it's a blessing that I get to see it for a year. Yeah. So it's really cool.
So then when you did decide that you wanted to go to JUCO, what did you learn about yourself in those first 2 years at Northeastern in Colorado?
You just kind of just find who you are, because you're in a little city in the middle of nowhere, and you're just going out and hooping, so you get to really fall in love with basketball and also with your close friends.
Yeah, did you feel like, too, like your maturity, too, kind of grew because you realized, like, okay, if I want to continue to go up the next level, I need to take my academics seriously. I need to put in the time in the gym as well, which I know you already did, like, in high school, but those things that you don't really realize until you're on your own, until you're out of the house, away from your parents, that you're like, okay, I need to do this for me now.
Yeah, I mean, JUCO, you pretty much just grow up. You have to be grown up to pretty much survive there. I mean, that's kind of like RC's been through it on the coaching staff. He knows JUCO life, and it's not easy, but, like, you really get to find yourself there. So I loved it when I was there, and I know every single person that goes through JUCO, they love it and miss it right away.
Do you still hear from some of those coaches, too, that I'm sure they're so proud of you for?
Oh, yeah, I call them every day. Yeah. We call each other. I mean, I would be on the phone with Coach Trinkle, Coach Bronson all the time. We'll always be talking crap, or we'll always just talk no matter what. After I'm done working out, I'll give them a call, or they'll just give me a call randomly, so I always stay in close contact with them.
So then you transferred to the University of Northern Colorado, and you were there for 2 seasons, led the Big Sky in scoring your senior year. How pivotal were those 2 years at the University of Northern Colorado to kind of like put yourself out there and put your name on the map for maybe the future of what was to come?
I mean, it got me here, and I loved it. I loved every single moment I was there. Like, it was a great school. It was a great spot for me at the time, and ultimately just it made me who I am today. Just going out, hooping, playing confident is where I got that from, as well as JUCO. But, I mean, like I said, it was kind of crazy because they recruit a lot of Colorado kids, and we grew up all playing against each other. Now we're on the same team, too. So, I mean, I loved it while I was there.
Mm-hmm. When you did finish your senior year and you thought about what options were next for you, What were the conversations like? Who were you kind of leaning on in those moments to decide what you wanted your next step to be?
It was with my parents. I mean, I wanted to put my name into the draft or just try to see where I'd be, where I was at. Mm-hmm. And we talked to some agencies with my coaches there, and we all heard that they said, like, if you want to make a name for yourself, you need to go back to college and play higher competition and just kind of bet on yourself. And that's what I did. I was confident. My coaches there were like, yeah, I mean, if that's your dream, go do it. And then obviously my parents were all for it, just saying it's going to be hard, but I mean, if you put your mind to it, you got it. So that's what I did. And it's been a blessing ever since.
Yeah. It paid off pretty well for you because you're here. So when you took your visit here and you got to see Knoxville, got to see campus, what were your first thoughts?
I mean, I fell in love with it. I mean, we went to the spring game and you seen 60,000 people in the football stance, and I didn't know if that's crazy or not, but I just seen 60,000 people for a spring game. I'm like, wow, that is crazy. Like, they show support. And the fans here are crazy. I mean, I love them. I mean, when I was on my visit, they were all talking to coach and they knew who I was. Okay. It was a blessing. I loved it while I was here on my visit. And that's a big reason why I came here, was because the fans were really supportive, and as well as like my teammates. I really loved all of my teammates. I loved all the coaches, Coach Barnes and RC. They were all big influences for me to come to Tennessee.
Have you ever experienced being around town and little kids or families recognizing you and wanting pictures or autographs or anything?
The first time was with my mom in Target. A little kid and a mom came up to me and asked for a picture, and that made my mom smile. And it was really cool for me to experience that, but also like seeing my mom, her smile, like kind of just paying off like my hard work. Mm-hmm. I always dreamed of that stuff. So
yeah,
it's really cool when kids or parents will come up to me and ask for a picture or autographs. I love it. I mean, it's so cool.
You mentioned that Katie too is somebody that you would like to sit down and have dinner with over a conversation. Knowing that Coach Barnes coached him, how exciting was that potential opportunity to have your own experience of being a student of the master that helped KD now into his career?
I mean, that was another big thing. Like, he coached my favorite player. He made him, I mean, he helped him get to where he was. I mean, it's really cool just to see him go out and hoop. And he'll teach me some stuff, show me some film of back in the college days, like, same stuff that I'd be struggling with, he was struggling with. And we'll watch the film. He'll show me my clips and his clips are very similar. And then he'll be like, see what he did. Like, it's a blessing just to see from a great player like him.
Right. And someone whose game is, like you kind of mentioned, similar to yours. So then when you do go back and watch that film, I don't know how learning for you, if you're a visual learner or you like to like do it yourself or whatever it is, but I'm very visual. I need to see it.
Yeah,
I need to be able
me
to
too.
Emulate it. So like seeing it happen and seeing how he made his changes and then how you can easily do that next because you've seen it probably helps you a lot too.
Yeah, I mean, it helps a lot. I mean, I know you always pay attention to someone that you like love watching play. So
yeah,
it's a lot cooler just to go out and watch one of your favorite players do the same exact stuff as you.
Yeah. I read a funny article about how you went from getting zero texts, you know, when you were leaving high school about schools that wanted to reach out to you, get you to come, yada, yada, to then 500 missed calls. You had 1,200 text messages to answer because you'd put your phone away and went to practice. You're like, I know my name's going into the portal today. I'm going to block it out for a little bit. Do me. And then you came back to an overwhelming amount of positive feedback.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't even know when I was going to hit the portal. Okay. And I woke up and it was like 8:30. I went up to get some weight, or go lift some weights and then go shoot in the gym. And then I get back and phone's just blowing up. Like, my phone's already at 20% and it was 100%.
Oh, my gosh. Like, it drained your battery.
It drained my battery. I was like, this is crazy. Like, even my parents' phones are getting blown up. Like,
oh, man.
It was a really cool experience just to see that stuff. But it also was like, man, I got so much work to do. I got to text all these guys back. I got to text all the programs, coaches, and all this back.
Yeah,
so.
It's going to be a process now to figure out where you want to land.
Mm-hmm.
And then you landed here. April 21st, you put on your Instagram that you were committing to Tennessee with, you know, you experienced the campus, you experienced the culture, you experienced the fan base. Before you even stepped foot on campus in May for first practice, what were you most looking forward to?
I would say just getting ready for the season. I just was ready to.
You're ready.
Yeah, I was ready for practice. I was just ready to get off to my new chapter. So I was just waiting for that stuff, and I loved it when I was here. And I just can't, I just wish I was here longer, kind of. So
yes.
So I could play here longer, be in front of everybody and stuff. So
when you think about, too, you grew up in Colorado your whole life, went to school there, too. Were you nervous at all to now go out of state, southeast, a flight away from family, friends, your hometown? Were there any nerves there for you?
Yeah, I mean, I drove out here, so it was a 19-hour drive. And I'm never doing that drive again. I'll ship my car out. Like that was horrible. Even me and my dad and my mom were just all cramped up.
It was the worst,
but... I mean, other than that, I mean, it's not too bad. Like, okay. Living on your own, like, kind of similar to JUCO. I was in a small town. I was about 2 hours out from my house. So it was kind of similar to that, just now 19 hours instead of two.
I went to school 6 hours from home, so I also was, like, a pretty far, I mean, not 19 hours far, drive away from home. But I couldn't just hop home on the weekends when I wanted to. It also was another level of, I'm on my own. Like, this is for me now. And it also is less of a distraction, too. Like, you have your life here, you're establishing yourself here, and you got to figure it out. And basketball was a big way to help you do that.
Yeah.
Let's talk, too, about Coach Barnes and his mentorship to you, because I know that in wanting to, you mentioned continue playing at the collegiate level, you wanted to grow your game, and you wanted to be a more, you wanted to play against more competition, especially improve your defensive side of the game. So, how has that been so far, learning under Coach Barnes and being a student of such a legendary coach?
Obviously, he's a Hall of Fame coach, and I decided to come here because they're the number one defensive team in the country for the last several years. So I knew it would help me improve my defense and become an overall better player, not only just defense, but also just understanding the game, I mean, by, like, how if I take one dribble here, how the defense will shift. Like, that's kind of where I'm, like, really learning is learning how that plays out, too, as long as the defensive side, and just seeing, like, if I take one dribble here, pass it there, to make it so much easier for me and my teammates. And just learning the game from Coach. I mean, Hall of Fame coach, so he knows a lot.
Yeah, he's pretty legit.
Oh, yeah, very legit.
You came in May, and then there was a pretty fun trip that was planned that you got to be a part of. You got to go to Italy with the team for a little over a week. Can you talk about what that was like, just getting to spend that time with your teammates and build those really close relationships, having a trip like that to kind of bridge you guys together?
Yeah, I mean, it was a real fun experience for all of us. I mean, all of us transfers and freshmen get to go hoop with them overseas and go play against the competition over there. It was big for us, but also just staying off the court, go shopping, go get some food or go wherever, just go hang out and do stuff besides basketball to really get to know your teammates.
Yeah, what'd you think of the food?
I thought it was pretty good. Yeah. I mean, there were some spots that were kind of decent that I think I could cook better, but
okay. Otherwise, are you a big cook?
No.
Okay.
I think I could try.
Okay.
But other than that, I mean, Italy had great food, and it was.
You guys
took
a cooking
experience.
Class there too, right? Did your team win? Because it was competition.
Of course,
kind of.
We won.
Really? Yeah. What'd you guys make?
Some type of spaghetti. I'm not too sure.
Was it good?
Yeah. Okay. Of course.
I mean, if you won, it's got
to be
pretty
good.
Yeah.
If we won, it has to be good.
Yeah, it does. What other things did you enjoy while you guys were there?
I would say the Coliseum was really cool to see, because I always wanted to see that in person. So I got to see that, and just seeing kind of like the different type of culture was over there compared to the over here. It was kind of cool to see.
So Coliseum's in Rome. Where else did you go?
We went to Milan and Florence.
Okay. Your favorite spot out of the three?
I'd have to say Milan was not my favorite. I mean, I left some stuff at the airport, so that's why I kind of got some bad memories with Milan.
Yeah, you have a little PTSD from Milan.
Yeah, so other than that, I'd say Florence and Rome were my two favorite spots for sure.
I went to Italy. I studied abroad after my freshman year of college, and it's a little controversial in the office apparently, but I did not like Florence. That was not my personal favorite spot. I thought Venice was just out of a magazine. I thought it was so beautiful on the water. I obviously haven't been back since there was like a really big flood that happened there, so I don't know if there was much destruction that happened, but I just thought it was so beautiful. But people like Florence a lot too, so that's fine. But I also went to Rome, and I thought it was just so crazy walking around, and then you have like ruins to your left and the Colosseum to your right. It's like
gelato stores everywhere.
Yes,
that was great.
That was so great.
The whole team would just go, like,
yeah,
me and Z during a tour, we would just drift off and go get our own gelato.
So when you guys were there, back on the basketball topic, of course, played three games. It was the first time you got to wear the orange and white. International exhibitions where you led the team in scoring and you averaged 16.3 points. So the opportunity to get that time to gel and to compete with your team, to see how everyone's kind of games meshed together. Can you talk about what that was like?
We all played against each other the whole entire summer, so we kind of got to understand our game. And just going out and competing every single day, like, we kind of all get to know each other's favorite moves and stuff. So it's also just fun just to go out and hoop with each other instead of against each other. So we had a lot of fun. I know that. And I mean, it was just a real fun experience.
So you come back. That was what? Early August. You come back and you start to get ready and to practice and prepare for the schedule because it came fast and furious. I know October was a crazy month, and the fact that we were starting basketball was also crazy. But you started off with a bang, and by bang I mean the dunk that was pretty much heard around the NCAA basketball world, because I saw that video all over my timeline. But for those who don't know, when you guys played number 4 Michigan State in your exhibition game, it was a dunk that turned into a 3-point play that was huge for the team, especially being on the road in that game in front of that environment. What was that moment like for you? Like, do you remember it? Can you walk me through
it? Yeah, I mean, I remember it. I just remember Shaq got a great block on the other end, and I grabbed it, put it behind my back against somebody, and then just went up to dunk it on somebody. Yeah. So I'm like, I don't know what was really going through my head. I was just like,
it was like an out of body experience. You're just locked in. And
yeah, I was more locked in to like actually knowing what I just did. I mean, I seen all my teammates' faces and they were just going crazy. Yeah. So like, I mean, it was just a real cool experience.
Yeah.
For like seeing Z on the sideline, his face, Josiah's face, of course. And then just it was real fun.
And it was also like your first experience playing a team of that caliber, being in an environment like that. What was that experience like?
I mean,
for you
always want to us, like, both teams, I feel like, took that as a real game. I mean, 100%. All of us did.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you grow up, everybody grows up wanting to play in those games, a high ranked game, and I was just really waiting for it, because I knew it was my time to shine, and as well as the team's time to shine. And it was just real fun just go out there and hoop with my teammates, and we got the win. So that's all that mattered.
Yeah, exactly. Even though Twitter said it didn't count because of an exhibition, it did count. We all counted.
Oh, it counted. Two coaches that were best friends too. Yes. It counted.
Yes, it was great to come home with that momentum and seeing you guys play at that level. I'm sure it was like, okay, like, this is, we've set the tone for what this team can be this season.
Yeah,
so that was
for
really
sure.
Exciting.
And we always felt like we were a special team too. Yeah. So just got to go out there and prove it.
Yeah, exactly. Also in that first week, you earned SEC Player of the Week honors, and you hit your 1,000 point milestone in your career, which I don't think people understand too, that it wasn't including your JUCO years that you hit that, because you had to be at the NCAA level.
Yeah.
So it wasn't even including those first 2 years that you played. So what, I mean, so much was happening for you in your first week. Like, were you processing all of it? Were you able to like soak it all in, or was it just, you know,
I didn't even know, to be honest, like,
until the Instagram post, you didn't know.
Yeah. Like, JUCO, I kept track. I hit 1,000 in JUCO and I was happy, but like, ever since I went up to Division One, I mean, I never really kept track. I knew I was close from after, my second year there, but I think I hit it after I hit the layup over Wisconsin.
Yes.
The game, like, winning layup or whatever. But
yeah,
it was real cool. I mean, it was a cool experience. And, I mean, who doesn't want to hit 1,000 points at Division One?
Yeah.
I know a couple other teammates have hit it, so it's real cool.
Also, I want to talk about one of probably your first taste of what, you know, Food City Center has the potential to be with our fan base was in the Illinois game. Oh. That place, I mean, I was a fan for that game, was rocking. It was packed out, sold out game as well. What was that experience like for you to see everybody show up at noon on a Saturday for that game?
I mean, it was crazy just to go out there and see that and hear how loud the crowd got and stuff. It was so awesome, like, just going out there and being on the floor, look around in the crowd. Like, after everyone scores, we'll all look around, and it's just going crazy. It's unbelievable. I mean, that's what the coaching staff told me on my visits. These fans don't mess around. Like, they're going to be at the games ready.
Yeah.
And I just can't wait for SEC and stuff, and for them to sell out those crowds too.
Mm-hmm. To your point, just like nothing you've ever experienced before.
Nothing like that. Yes. It was awesome. I loved it.
Speaking of Illinois game, your non-conference schedule in general, Tennessee probably had one of, if not the toughest schedule in NCAA, playing the teams that you did. I mean, number one and number two, Kansas and Purdue in the Maui Invitational.
Back to back.
After playing Syracuse, too. Yeah. So like three games pretty close in proximity to each other. Then traveling to Chapel Hill to take on number 17 UNC, where, oh, yeah, you dropped a career best 37 points. Try to throw it out there. And then, like we talked about, beating Illinois, number 20 at the time, and led the team with 21 points yourself. So how were those experiences in the non-conference season just alone? How did they help you and kind of give you a taste of what's to come in SEC conference play and even postseason down the line?
That's another big reason why I came here. We're going to play the best of the best always, every single night. And it's not only going to be, if the win or loss, it's not going to be just for that. It's going to be where we can make ourselves better in the film to watch and help us improve to be that much better. So yeah. It was really good just to go out and play against those top teams so we could learn from our mistakes. And ultimately, just it's going to be make us that much better by the time SEC play starts and as well as March.
We've already played Ole Miss and Mississippi State thus far. Your first year in the SEC playing against these teams, what are you most looking forward to?
I'm just excited just to go out and play against top teams every single game. That was one of my biggest things was going out there. I mean, on my visit, they said this is the closest thing to the NBA, and that's my ultimate goal. This is the NBA league, they say. So I just can't wait to just go out there and play against the best of the best every single night and prove myself. And as well as a team, we're going to prove ourselves that we're one of the best in the nation.
Through these games, before we get to even the postseason, what are you hoping to grow specifically, like in your game, or just grow as a player in general?
Yeah, I mean, I'm just trying to improve my game, just to be an overall better player everywhere and each way. And I know as a team, we're just going to go out there and just dominate as a team and just be ready to go play against SEC play and go play in the SEC tournament and then go in March and go kill it. Yeah. We're all just really excited.
I know we talked a little bit about your family, and I just want to touch on them real quick, too. Seeing your career and your success and from where you started to where you are now, if they were here to talk to you or talk to us about how proud they are of you, what do you think they would say?
Your hard work paid off, yeah. I'd say, is probably the best thing they would say is just – you were in the gym every single day, and you got what you put in, so
and
props to you.
Yeah, and you didn't end up here by accident, right? You had to commit to yourself to be here, so it's a really wonderful story of just don't give up on your dreams. I mean, I think we talked about that, too, before one of the games, where you were like, that was my motto. It was just don't give up on your dreams, and you had really big dreams for yourself.
And always just keep a chip on your shoulder. Got something to prove.
You have always had those NBA dreams and aspirations. When that time does come, what excites you about your future after your time here at Tennessee? What are you going to take with you and from this experience that you've had here on Rocky Top?
Just the culture here is something. I mean, every team's winning here. It's a winning university. So that's something that I'd always take in. Just always the moments that I've had here is always going to be always stuck with me. With, the fans, my teammates, the coaches, the games, obviously. So all that stuff's going to stick with me forever, and I love here in Knoxville.
Oh, that's so good. Yeah. Oh, I love it. Well, before I let you go, Dalton, this has been so good, but I have one question for you, and we ask everybody on the podcast this question. So when you sing Rocky Top, do you woo?
Yeah, I would say.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean, everybody does, so you kind of have to.
It's the culture now, but I will tell you that back in the day, people didn't woo.
I mean, I just seen my teammates do it, so I had to follow them.
You
so
woo, the crowd woos, everyone woos.
Everybody woos.
Yeah,
so.
Wow.
You have to,
and it's fun, and it's,
why not?
Why not? Well, Dalton, thank you so much for joining me on the podcast. I really appreciate it.
Of course. Thanks for having me.
Thanks so much, everyone, for listening to our first Everything Orange episode of the new year. Be sure to follow us on all of our Vol Sports platforms so you don't miss out on a single update. But before we go, here's a look at everything going on with Tennessee Athletics this upcoming week, which, of course, begins with basketball. Tonight, the women's basketball team is hosting the Florida Gators at 7 p.m. in the Food City Center. Then tomorrow and Saturday, track is competing in the Commodore Challenge in Nashville, Tennessee, and the Gamecock Opener in Columbia, South Carolina. Then specifically on Friday, men's tennis kicks off the start of their spring season against Furman at 1 p.m. inside the Good Friend Tennis Center. Then on Saturday, men's basketball is on the road to take on the Georgia Bulldogs at noon on ESPN2. While at home, men's tennis takes on Penn at 10 a.m. and Tennessee Tech at 3 p.m. inside the Good Friend Tennis Center. Then on Sunday, we've got more tennis and more basketball, this time for the women, though. The Lady Vols will take on Furman at 1 p.m., then Chattanooga at 4 p.m., all over in the Good Friend Tennis Center. Then the women's basketball team takes on the Texas A&M Aggies in College Station at 5 p.m. Lastly, on Tuesday, the men's basketball team takes on the Florida Gators at home in the Food City Center at 7 p.m. on ESPN. Well, that's a wrap on Rocky Top. Tune in next Thursday for another episode of Everything Orange. Bye, y'all.